The Bureau for External Affairs of the Agency for International Development presents AIDNET, the agency's video news service to 77 aid missions around the world.
I'm Bart Cull of AID External Affairs. Welcome you to Edition 7 of AIDNET. Here's a summary of the events we'll be covering on this edition. A joint press conference with Aid Administrator Peter McPherson and Ethiopian Relief Commissioner Dawit, and a report from the administrator on his return from a relief assessment trip to Ethiopia. The presentation of the second annual Presidential World Without Hunger Awards was held in Washington. We'll have a talk with the Director General of the International Rice Research Institute of the Philippines, and a report on the 20th anniversary observance of the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance, a visit with an aid colleague from our mission in Swaziland, and a report on the official inauguration of the airport in Granada. First, the emergency situation in drought-stricken Ethiopia has been the focus of a great deal of attention. On November 1st, Aid Administrator Peter McPherson held a series of meetings in Washington with Ethiopian Relief Commissioner Dawit, which were characterized by McPherson as highly productive.
Commissioner Dawit has agreed on behalf of his government that substantial additional trucks will be provided, the exact number to be determined pursuant to an immediate review of the situation. As I think all of you recall, we have felt for some time that additional trucks were important, and so we view this to be a very important step. Commissioner Dawit confirms that food shipments will be given top priority at ports. Inasmuch as in the next few weeks and months, we think that substantial additional food will need to be moved through those ports, we too think that this is a very important step. It is further confirmed by Commissioner Dawit that the private voluntary organizations will be allowed to distribute food to needy people throughout Ethiopia. The U.S., on its part, commits to an additional 50,000 ton of food to be moved through the government of Ethiopia. As I think most of you recall, we have to date worked or delivered food exclusively through private voluntary organizations based upon food being delivered efficiently and pursuant to control and careful of the U.S. Carefully done pursuant to U.S. regulation. The U.S. Will really very carefully consider additional food to be delivered through the Ethiopian government. The U.S. will provide 50% of the in-country transportation costs for this additional 50,000 ton. Ethiopia government will find money for the other 50%.
Dawit also agreed to provide substantially more trucks to move relief supplies to the feeding stations.
I can assure you that relief supplies will reach every sector of the population, in some places with difficulties and some places with certain security arrangements, but we are able to reach all sectors of population inside Ethiopia.
Administrator McPherson confirmed that the U.S. has leased two private cargo planes to airlift supplies. Since October 1st, the United States has authorized $60 million in aid to Ethiopia consisting of food, medical supplies, and air transport. On November 9th, following his return from a personal visit to Ethiopia, McPherson held a news conference. In it, he reflected on what he saw and heard.
But you don't see very many times, and I've never seen, hundreds of children who were like shrunken little old men with no belly, almost no flesh. I've never seen it.
Underlined the fact that the emergency, while focused on Ethiopia, threatens several African nations.
It's important to keep constantly in mind that this is an Africa-wide problem. And what we're seeing in a very serious way right now in Ethiopia, unless prompt and careful action is taken by all the world, we're going to see in many other places in Africa.
Spoke of the logistical problems of delivery.
Current logistical system is not able to put food through in excess of 50,000 ton at this time. probably less. But yet, it appears to us, our judgment as of this time, is that you need twice the food through that logistical chain that is now possible to get through the chain.
And called for a conference of donors and the Ethiopian government to coordinate the overall relief effort. Earlier, some of the people in the United States who have been working throughout the year to end world hunger were honored at a Washington ceremony at the Kennedy Center. The second annual presidential World Without Hunger Awards included celebrities Eddie Albert, Jeff Bridges, John Denver, and others. Government officials included Administrator Peter McPherson and Deputy Administrator Jay Morris, along with representatives of private voluntary organizations and the private sector. Master of Ceremonies Harvey Korman provided the lighter side.
Comedy that I was going to do, but I told her that was not appropriate, and besides, people in Washington here don't like comedy. You must have hated the debates.
As the 1984 honorees were introduced. The Educator Scientist Award went to Dr. Arthur Mosier, a pioneer of the agricultural extension movement abroad. Government legislative honoree was Congressman Benjamin Gilman of New York, author of a variety of legislation focused on world hunger. The Celebrity Award was presented to actor Eddie Albert for his continuing personal leadership commitment to ending world hunger. The Corporate Award was presented to Rodale Press, whose publications reach to over 13 million readers around the world. The award was accepted by publisher Robert Rodale. Winning the Private Voluntary Organization Award was Meals for Millions, and accepted by Philip Burton, chairman of the organization's board of directors. The Lifetime Achievement Award recipient was C. Payne Lucas, founder of Africare, an organization committed to relieving hunger and poverty in Africa. The award was accepted on behalf of his wife, Dr. Freddie Lucas.
Here's to the winners. Lift up the glasses. Here's to the glory still to be. Here's to the battle, whatever it's for, to ask the best of ourselves, then give much more.
AIDNET joins in congratulating the winners of the Presidential World Without Hunger Awards who were nominated by their peers. The Director General of the International Rice Research Institute in Los Banos, the Philippines, was in Washington recently, and while in the capital, Dr. M.S. Swaminathan talked to our production director, Isella Edwards, about some interesting insights on the effects of high-yielding rice on the economies of developing countries.
Well, in the last 10 to 15 years, thanks to high-yielding varieties of rice, rice production has kept above population growth rate. In fact, most of the densely populated countries of Asia, China and India, Bangladesh, Indonesia, they are the ones where rice is a very important staple, and they have all, the per capita food production has been satisfactory. Three things we must remember when we talk about high yielding varieties of rice. The varieties themselves have only a potential for high yield, but whether the potential is actually expressed or not will depend upon a whole series of management factors, application of nutrients, particularly fertilizer, giving water, proper pest management, and improved post-harvest operations, harvesting, threshing, and drying. In the past, 20 years ago, many experts said that the farmers of Asia are not very receptive to new ideas, and the farmers have shown these experts to be wrong. Because if three things are put together in a proper combination, then agricultural progress is fairly rapid. Number one is an economically viable and ecologically adapted technological package. The rice variety with the appropriate management practices. That is number one. That is the foundation for progress. Once we have that basic technological package, then we have to tailor it with appropriate package of services. Supply of credit, supply of knowledge, but particularly extension. Farmers must be convinced that this package will be more beneficial to them. And finally, the government policies must be such that they can stimulate both production and consumption. In other words, the price of inputs and the price of output, the input-output pricing policy. As I said, after all, the farmers produce for the market in excess to their own requirements, in which case the government policies on pricing, procurement, and marketing become exceedingly important. So if we have a suitable package of technology supported by appropriate packages of services and public policies, then recent evidence has shown that agricultural production can go very fast. Indonesia increased its rice production thanks to also help from AID and IRRI from 10 million tons in 1970 to over 25 million tons this year. India improved its wheat production from 10 to 12 million tons in 1966 to 45 million tons this year. Therefore, there is room for optimism on the food front, provided we know that it is farmers who produce food. And so long as we do justice to the farmers will do their best to produce more food.
Thank you very much for being here with us.
The Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance celebrated the 20th anniversary of its programs recently. The ceremonies featured remarks about the early years from Stephen Tripp, the first director. Retired General Julius Becton, Jr. is the current OFDA director. Aid Administrator Peter McPherson assisted Becton in presenting awards to individuals and offices providing support over the years. And speaking of years, during the past 20 years, the United States has helped the victims of 729 disasters in 121 countries affecting well over 2 million people. Earlier this season, we had a visit too from Deputy Director Jimmy Pilpot of our mission in Swaziland. He talked with Isella Edwards about the work of the mission there.
We have a rather firm belief in the mission in Swaziland that human resources development is one of the most important things that we can engage in, because we're training the leaders of the institutions that we're working with for the future. This
is long-range training.
We look at it as a very long-range kind of an investment that may not pay off the highest dividends in the near term, say through the first 5 years, but after that, it will pay very high dividends. The current CDSS that we have in Swaziland identified four technical constraints to development in 1979 when the assessment was done. Low productivity on the traditional land, we call it Swazi Nation land, a very high under 2 mortality rate among amounting to about 172 children would die before age 2 out of every 1,000 that were born, among the highest in the world. Rapid population growth was another constraint, as was a concomitant variable, the rising unemployment. Our programs have been largely designed to do this, but initially working on the longer range human resources factors that we think will pay off in the end. For example, we began revising the curriculum in the primary schools of Swaziland some 9 years ago. The project is winding down with a distinctly Swazi curriculum in place in those schools now, rather than the old British academic system, which didn't train the Swazis for the kinds of work and economic activities that would be, and I think this was an obvious course of action. We were criticized to some extent by others for trying to install an American curriculum in Swaziland, but in fact, it was not an American curriculum. We brought American advisors in to provide the technique. How do you develop a curriculum? But the curriculum is very distinctly Swazi and not our own. We are just now completing work on a new Swaziland manpower development project, which will continue activities that we've done in the past, but expand them beyond simple academic training abroad and in third countries, and providing some operating expert personnel to replace the Swazis sent away for training. We see a very major need to reach the people who play the biggest part or the strongest role in decision making in a traditional society, and these are the traditional leaders in the countryside.
Chiefs, kind of.
These are the chiefs who in a traditional society such as Swaziland's are the key figures in the local areas. Now, this is a country with 85% of its population living in rural areas. And we've noticed over time that there's a wide variation in the kinds of development that can take place in various parts of Swaziland. And it seemed to us, and we've verified this, that the attitude of the chief in charge of that area makes perhaps the greatest difference in what happens and how well people assimilate and adapt the new technologies we make available to them and put them into practice in their daily lives.
So if the chief is very amenable to change in
his... Then you get a good deal of change in his area. The people respond, they're enthusiastic, you get community projects, you get school committees that demand better teachers, better school services, better books, and the like.
Our final story is one of celebration. On the first anniversary of the rescue mission to Grenada, the Port Saline International Airport was dedicated. And representing the United States government, Aid Administrator Peter McPherson said, "It's a proud day for freedom, a proud day for people of this bright and beautiful Caribbean island. In free, secure Grenada, the airport is a doorway to new investment, increased employment, and economic growth." McPherson added that the U.S. Agency for International Development has been pleased to play a major part in the project, as well as other development efforts. And with that, we'll close our seventh edition of AIDNET. As always, we welcome your thoughts and suggestions on how we can serve your interests better. It's been a pleasure to be with you today. I'm Bart Cull of AID External Affairs, wishing you a very pleasant holiday season.